Welcome, everybody. Thanks for joining us online tonight for the beginning of our Easter weekend together. So I don't know about you, but when I think about Easter, I typically think about the resurrection and celebrating the resurrection. And we'll get to that. We'll celebrate the resurrection with three services. We're going to do a Saturday service tomorrow night at 6:30. That's Saturday night. And then we'll come back together also on Sunday morning if you miss the Saturday night, and we'll do a 9 and a 10:45 service Sunday morning. We will not be doing a Sunday night service this week because we want to make sure that families have plenty of time to be able to celebrate together this weekend. So, but tonight is a little bit different. Although Easter, typically we focus on the resurrection, I think it's really good just to pause and slow down and specifically think about Jesus' sacrifice for us on the cross. And so we'll do that by reflecting on the last seven words of Jesus on the cross. And my prayer is that as you reflect on these words and the speakers tonight, that God really would remind you just how much he loves you and what he gave for you. So, Father, thanks for this opportunity to get together like this. And there is no sure demonstration of your great love for us, that Romans tells us that while we were yet sinners, far off, that Christ died for us. You didn't wait for us to get our acts together or somehow grovel or prove that we were worthy. It's your sure demonstration and a picture of your commitment to us that you were willing to die for us while we were still sinners. So Lord, as we reflect on these words tonight, I pray, Father, that you would help us be reminded just of what it is that you've done for us and this great demonstration of your love and your commitment to us. In Jesus' name we thank you. Amen.
Luke 23:24. But Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." In this, I believe Jesus exemplifying how he calls us to live. In the Lord's Prayer, he tells us to forgive those who trespass against us. He also tells us to love our enemies and to pray for those who persecute us and spitefully use us. Jesus demonstrates all these things on the cross as he prays for those who are crucifying him. One of the hardest things I've struggled with is forgiving those who I feel have wronged me, specifically at a time when I was young and vulnerable. I think what makes it difficult is I still feel the negative impacts today. You know, I could say I still suffer with those things today. But I have my example in Jesus, that while he was in the middle of his suffering, he still offered forgiveness. And that even though I share in the responsibility for his suffering, he still offers me forgiveness.
Luke 23:43. Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Truly I say to you, a phrase Jesus would use to emphasize the importance of the words that were to follow. Every word Jesus spoke was relevant and true, But this phrase is one he used when the thing he was about to say was a key point, something to pay particularly close attention to. Today, you will be with me in paradise. So profoundly did Scripture influence and impact Jesus' thoughts that even in the most difficult moments, Jesus was thinking in the language of Scripture. The word paradise used here is the same Greek word used in the Old Testament for the Garden of Eden. And in the garden, Adam was with God. In Genesis, we learned that Adam walked with God, working with God as he embraced and embodied his divine purpose. When Jesus speaks to the criminal hanging next to him, he is assuring him of the reality that is not the end, that this is not the end, that today the criminal will be with him in paradise, in the same way Adam was with God in the garden.
What is key here is the order of Jesus' pronouncement. Not that the criminal will be in paradise today, but that the criminal will be with Jesus. And that being with is the blessed state of being in paradise. As the man hangs on the cross, feeling the full weight of the Roman Empire coming down on him, he looks upon Jesus, an innocent man suffering the same cruel fate. However, what he sees is the exact opposite of his own reality. Jesus is not defeated. Despite the agony Jesus is experiencing, he prays for forgiveness for those that are mocking, torturing, and killing him. In this act of incredible forgiveness and mercy, the criminal realizes Jesus is who he says he is, the Messiah, and that this is how the Messiah overcomes the power of sin and death. The criminal recognizes that his life spent fighting Rome using violence only creates sorrow and hatred and would only lead to more injustice, more oppression, and more death. Instead, Jesus, right now in this moment, was completing the victory over these things, not just over Rome, but over all empires and over the powers of darkness. In a final act of repentance and faithfulness, the criminal cries out to Jesus, begging for the chance to experience all that he is offering him, begging for the chance to create joy, love, and life. Imagine his relief and elation when Jesus assures him that despite the life that he has lived, it is not too late for him, that even now he can repent, turn towards Jesus, and embrace complete redemption, that he can be with Jesus in paradise, just as Adam walked with God in the garden, living as a newly created person, fully participating in Jesus' creation-restoring activities, completely submitted to Jesus, his King, and enjoying eternity with him in his rescued and restored kingdom. And so Luke writes of Jesus and to us these words, "Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise," an invitation and an assurance of his love and faithfulness.
At the foot of the cross, where grace and suffering meet, you have shown me your love. The cross. foot of the cross, where I am made complete. You have given me life through the death you bore for me, and you've won my heart, and you've won.
John 19, 26 through 27 reads, "So when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple who he loved standing there, he said to his mother, 'Woman, look, here is your son.' And they said to his disciple, 'Look, here is your mother.' From that time, the disciple took her into his own home. On the cross, Jesus paid the ultimate price that none of us could, offering redemption and restoration into the relationship with God that we were created for. However, throughout his life, even in his final moments on the cross, he also laid down an example of how to live, a model for each of us to follow. One critically important part of this example is how to think of and treat others. In this, Jesus models for us a deep, genuine love. This is love without condition. It extends to strangers, losers, and outcasts, to the very least of these. But as we see here, it is also love for those closest and dearest to us. Even in the midst of immense suffering, Jesus never stops thinking of those around him. Two of the people before him are Mary and John. Mary is his mother, the one who comforted and cared for him when he was sick as a child, the one who treasured up stories about her son in her heart. John is one of his closest friends. The two had been through a lot together. Also worth mentioning, John had abandoned Jesus in a great time of need just the night before in a mountaintop garden."
Translated into English, Jesus speaks less than 10 words to these two. For so few words, we see a huge amount communicated. We see Jesus concerned for his mom and knowing that he won't be around to take care of her, taking steps to ensure someone else trustworthy will. In placing this responsibility on John, we see Jesus forgive his friend for abandoning him and renew and demonstrate his trust in him. And we see Jesus uniting people into a family who likely never would have met if not for him. His consideration and care for these two in his last moments is astounding. I know the default setting of my heart is to focus solely on myself. Only on my best days do I consider others and remember that as a Christian, I'm supposed to love my neighbor. Jesus never stops thinking of others, regardless of whether things seem to be going well or not for him. We learn that from his words here on Good Friday at his lowest. This model of love for others, even in the midst of our darkest days, is a tall challenge for me and for us, his followers, to strive to rise to. If, by the grace of God, we are even a little bit successful, we will be a light shining in the darkness of our world, a light that will bring life to those around us.
Matthew 27:46 reads, "At about 3 o'clock, Jesus shouted with a loud voice, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?' Although there were spectators, torturers, and supporters gathered nearby, no one could have ever felt more alone in that moment than Jesus. He was alone in a way we cannot even begin to comprehend, forsaken, abandoned, deserted. In the midst of carrying all the sin of the world on his shoulders, generations of sin past, present, and future bearing down on him, he was utterly alone. We don't know how long that isolation lasted, but we do know that in the midst of it, Jesus held tightly to his faith in God and cried out to him in a loud voice. Did he really hope for God to answer? For God to give him relief from his anguish? Or did he cry out for our benefit? Despite his agony, was his intent to model for us an everlasting hope? To remind us that when we cry out to him, God hears and God cares? That he will never leave us or forsake us, as it says in Deuteronomy 31:6? Jesus experienced the loss of God's presence, suffered excruciating pain, but bore it all willingly so we would never have to. The depth of our isolation here on earth could never compare to his. And because of his sacrifice, we need never experience it as he did. Because of his death and resurrection, we have complete access to our Heavenly Father anytime, any place. And we are given this assurance over and over again in his word. Psalm 18:6 says, "In my distress, I called to the Lord. I cried to my God for help. From his temple, he heard my voice. My cry came before him into his ears." There are few feelings worse than this sense of being alone, but oftentimes that is exactly what brings us to our knees and motivates us to seek God. That was the case in my life many years ago, and I can still clearly recall the moment, sitting alone in my bed, that I cried out to him. He revealed himself to me and assured me that he was at my side and wanted to give my life purpose, a future, and a hope. I still have a long way to go in regards to finding perfect peace in his presence, and too often I look for meaning in material things or people who were never meant to take his place. God has blessed us with community, and we would do well to nurture the relationships he has placed in our lives, to look for opportunities to know and be known by others, to invest more time and energy in serving people rather than serving ourselves. But ultimately, Jesus is the one that saves us from being alone. May we all cry out to him and take comfort in these words spoken by Jesus in Matthew 28:20. "And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age."
He is jealous for me. love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us, oh, oh, how he loves us, how he loves us, oh. And he is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. All of a sudden, I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. This grace is an ocean we're all sinking. Heaven meets earth like an unforeseen kiss. My heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way that he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. Yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves.
After this, Jesus, realizing that by this time everything was completed, said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." Jesus died in the flesh so that by God's grace he would experience death in our place. His crying out of "I thirst" reminds us of his physical being. Jesus was God, but while on earth he was also human. He had to become flesh and blood, and he suffered as we do. This is a powerful reminder. Not only does God love me and look after me, but Jesus can actually relate and sympathize with what I am going through. As we wrestle with our personal struggles, we experience a thirst that can only be satisfied by a cup of living water, which flows from Jesus. His cry, which shows his extreme thirst, is something we can all identify with. By Jesus calling out for something to drink, he shows his knowledge of Scripture and his determination to fulfill it. Psalm 69:21 says, "They gave me poison for food, and for my thirst they gave me sour wine to drink." Jesus in his humanity experienced every trial and tribulation that we face. We often overlook this. When I'm struggling either in my faith or with life's trials, it is easy for me to forget Jesus' humanity, but I think we are meant to take great comfort in that. This year alone has been a very difficult one for me. I was falling into old patterns of sin on a daily basis, which only separated me from God even more. I did not realize how far from Him I had fallen until I was at a point where I felt ashamed to call out for help from Him. My spirit was thirsting for His love and healing, but my mind convinced me differently. I was just beginning to rebuild my relationship with Jesus when I was asked to share for this Good Friday service. He prompted me to say yes because He knew I was thirsting for Him, and what better way to draw me back to Him than to delve into a scripture about thirst. As I spent time in His Word this past week, one of the most important things I have come to understand is that we will always have battles to face on this earth, but we aren't alone. We can be encouraged by Hebrews 4:15 through 16. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need.
When he had received the sour wine, Jesus said, "It is completed." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. John 19:30. The completeness of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross is something that often escapes us. It is final and finished. In John 1:29, John the Baptist proclaimed upon seeing Jesus, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And in Hebrews 10:11 and 12, we read, "Day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again, he offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when this priest had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God." The reality of our past, present, and future sins is that Jesus took them away. Jesus' completed work on the cross challenges us not only to connect with the depth of his suffering and sacrifice, but also to accept that the issue of sin and guilt is finished. As we meditate upon the sacrifice that Jesus made in giving up his life for us, let it resonate within our hearts that, as Scripture constantly reminds us, this sacrifice was once for all. There is nothing we can add to something that is already finished and complete. With respect to our forgiveness, there is no work left to do. In Isaiah 53:5, we read, "But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed." In my own life, I've had to realize that there is no punishment left. God's justice that demanded death for my sin was completely satisfied by the sacrifice of Jesus. Every day, I need to rely on, depend on, and rest in that truth. The more I do this, the less I'm held back and overcome with guilt for my failures. Jesus' sacrifice on the cross is not merely a ticket to heaven for us, but rather a path to freedom from guilt and condemnation.
Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Luke 23:46. Through this simple statement, Jesus taught us a profound truth, how to trust and surrender to the Father. In his agony, he demonstrated complete trust and surrender to the Father's will, knowing that the Father's will was good. Jesus did this as a man. Philippians 2 tells us he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. He had become one of us. As Christians, we are called every day to commit our spirits to God. This means giving up my own will and self-centered desires to live for the kingdom of God. It is a daily choice I get to make. It has looked as simple as an apology to preserve a relationship, an act of love and kindness to someone outside of my circle of friends, understanding how much I need to live in community with other Christians, or even having the boldness to share who God is with someone who may not know him. This past year has been very challenging for everyone, and I have to constantly look to Christ and his example of surrender. I see Jesus encouraging all these things in the scriptures, and I know that this is his desire on how I should live. Not my will, but yours be done, Lord. This also means trusting in God, no matter what the circumstances are in my life. We've all experienced brokenness and the brokenness that sin has left on our world and in our lives, but I trust that the Father's will is good. He is sovereign. He sees a bigger picture that I will never be able to understand. He knows the beginning and the end. Jesus was able to trust the Father regardless of his circumstance, knowing that there was a plan and his purpose for his immense suffering. Our salvation would be accomplished through that suffering. He would redeem creation and defeat sin once and for all. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Jesus could have very well said this statement first, but these are his last words. It leaves us a lasting impression on how our Savior desires us to live, a life of complete trust and surrender.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
All right, everybody, thanks again for joining us tonight at home. Obviously a little bit different night because you're not all present. And it's different just because normally, you know, one of the things that we most look forward to doing when we gather together here at church is to spend time talking before service and especially after service, catching up with folks. But one of the things I really encourage people to do every year in this building when we're done is to not rush out of here, but to sit, and we give people all the time they need to sit quietly and reflect and allow to space in their hearts and their minds to continue to allow God to be with them, to teach them, to encourage them, just to sense God's love for you. And I want to encourage you at home to do the exact same thing. Whatever else you were going to do tonight, don't feel like you need to rush on to it, but just take a minute in silence with your friends or family and continue to be able to reflect and allow God's presence to be with you in a very rich and real way. Thank you, and I hope to see you later this weekend at our resurrection services.